to carry a microphone, and we'd be happy to address it. Or in the front, I could probably hear you. Shout out. Did you get a question? So, well, we got white. Right here, and then over here next.
Let's say the parents go the wrong way. What kind of disruption opening in the solar industry would that create?
Yeah, well, what do you mean your perspective? No, don't get rid of the microphone yet. Let me tell you your perspective on that first. Everybody has lots of opinions about the tariff and where things are going to go. What's your opinion, sir?
Well, another enormous importance of the media industry, but it seems like thin film technology, which won't be subject to the tariffs, will probably see a ramp up in development. And since that's tied to microprocessors or things of that nature, those are going to be advancing on a separate evolutionary line anyways, that'll benefit the solar industry. So I think we might just see a switch to a different type of panel that's not subject to the same tax criteria.
That's an interesting idea. So it's interesting that many people, when we talk about disruption, when we think about barriers to disruption or what creates disruption-proof industries, the first place that most everyone goes is regulation. And thus, regulation is what's going to shape whether or not there's disruption. So regulation being something that prevents competition from happening or something that encourages a particular type of competition. What we found is that oftentimes disruptive innovations start in tiers of the market or in places where there's non-consumption, where regulations haven't quite gotten there in terms of what, you know, them saying what needs to happen. What happens is those create market niches that improve over time and eventually get to the point where they're good enough, and then regulations come back and catch up afterwards. So we're seeing this now in a variety of different industries, from all these sharing industries to consumer drones to personal genomics. We have all these new industries where innovators are doing things that are very interesting. And yes, the regulatory environment is affecting them, but they're only affecting them at certain points in time, and not throughout. So I would say that's where I would sort of come down. Thank you. Over here. Sir?
What advice would you give to your employer about the disruptions happening in higher education?
Great question. So the question was, you know, what advice would I give my employer? First of all, I'm not a dean, so I tend not to give the dean a lot of advice. however, if the dean were to ask for my advice, I think the idea is that you sort of think about yourself as over in an insulated position in the market. Because we have this kind of status piece. Like, if we are going to be disrupted, we're going to be the last people to feel it. But we're actually feeling it right now. So we, you know, as you can imagine, everybody, lots of people, like, get in, decide to come. But there's lots of people now that are choosing not to even apply. And that's not going to show up on our radar. It certainly doesn't show up in the way that we collect data about what's happening in our industry. And so we, like everybody else in higher education, is trying to figure out if there is a profitable online business model that we can pursue. The problem is that we oftentimes try to do that while we're doing our current business, and we don't want to get in this kind of a hybrid situation of Blockbuster and Netflix, but that's exactly where we are right now. Great question. Good, any other questions?
Yes, thank you. I'll ask you to comment about traditional financing and venture capitalist models with disruptors like Kickstarter or crowdfunding and
sure.
Things like that, how it may impact the industry.
That's a good question. So kind of let's call it a fintech disruption in the context of startup funding. So traditionally, a lot of new businesses, new innovative businesses, those who were a little bit more risky for things like bank financing, were financed by venture capitalists, and they dominated the market for the last 20, 30 years, and they still dominate the market today. And what we're seeing is a lot of experimentation with new business models, whether they be super angels, incubators, accelerators, as you mentioned, online funding platforms. And what these are doing is they're funding businesses that would be outside the scope of what would be interesting to through traditional venture capitalists. So the fact that I fund the Pebble Watch as Kickstarter, that's not something that a venture capitalist would fund anyway. So they don't feel a lot of pain as they're being disrupted here. Moreover, their economics say, what? We need to create a bigger fund so that we can carry higher fees, collect more fees for managing this bigger fund. Well, what does that do? That makes sure that everything that is coming up that's a smaller business opportunity or is at an earlier stage isn't interesting for us. We need to allocate the capital. And so that's providing the impetus for people to do it. The other thing that's providing the impetus is you've got things that were traditionally very, very difficult to start a business. And now what you're having, you're seeing is you're having Amazon Web Services is allowing you to have access to these servers that you normally would have to buy previously. You don't have to get these expensive software licenses, and you can open up open source software. So it's becoming tremendously lower cost to start a company now, and that's great opportunities as well. Great question. Yes?
In the integrated steel situation, how much was caused by imports coming in to destroy the market, and how much was caused by the electric furnaces?
Yeah, great question.
And why would the price of scrap steel continue to go up when the steel was being made one more by scrap steel?
You would expect it to go up.
Right. I mean, a lot of it was exported to China.
So we would expect the steel price to go up as more and more competition happens.
The scrap steel.
The scrap steel, the input. So the question is, how much of this do you think is driven by mini mills versus how much of this is driven by other competitors in the market? Most, obviously the Europeans, Japan, and so forth. And so for students of history, you'll think about this as, what does something like World War II do? It's most devastating to the economy where those kinds of things happen. But at the same time, it provides an opportunity for manufacturing. So all these old, outdated steel mills were, you start a greenfield, you start anew, you can adopt the latest technologies. So these foreign makers of steel were extremely efficient relative to the integrated steel mills. So they were getting competition from both ends. They're getting competition from the Europeans and the Japanese, which are very efficient, and they're getting competition from the mini mills. And what's interesting to me is all these technologies were emerging in the industry at the time. And not a single one was ever adopted or built or even acquired. Something that we think would happen if there's a new technology that's this good for helping people produce commodities at low cost. So to answer your question, I would say it's driven by all of them. It just so happens that I don't have time for the full story. Great question.
Hi, I'm back here. My question is, you mentioned that incumbent firms, doing more dancing, incumbent firms don't disruptively innovate because they can't bear the risk of that low cost and high failure rate stage. So my question is, what's your take? Are incumbent firms, is it hopeless for them? Can they disruptively innovate, or is it on the small and mid-sized ventures to do the disruptive innovation?
Good question. So I think they can't. I don't think it's a doomsday story here. I think it's, but it does. It is a little bit pessimistic. Now we've seen in the past incumbent firms who have been able to disrupt. I think maybe we give the example of microprocessors. Certainly Intel, when it was emerging and growing at AMD, which was producing these really inexpensive microprocessors, Intel said, wow, we're thinking about that as a potential disruption, but it doesn't make any sense for us to go down there and make these cheap microprocessors when we're making so much in the business that we're in now. And what they did is they said, but at some point, that niche product is gonna get better and it's gonna feed into what we do. And so they created a separate business unit that went after that opportunity and treated it as an opportunity. So the problem is that the world looks very, very different to startups and big companies. For a startup, any customer is a good customer. For a big, large firm that already has existing customers, well, we get more discriminating about who we want as our customers, and we want the higher margin firms. And so the solution oftentimes is to take an opportunity and create a spin out or create a separate division that has a different cost structure, a and the big company is able to pursue that as an opportunity. In our most recently, we've got Amazon that's done that with the Kindle. We've been selling books online for many years. We know that somebody like Apple or Google is going to come into the market and disrupt us with digital books. And so we need to be able to get there before they get there. And did many of the same things that I'm describing. Great, thank you. Great question.
I got it. Most of the examples that you've been running through have been competitive industries where companies can choose where they want to buy their products from. But a lot of the folks in this room are working in a regular report environment, which is very different. Knowledge of the franchise and the geographic region. Mm-hmm. Do you have any examples of disruption happening in these more regulated markets? And what would you give for advice for companies who are trying to not only provide a better service, but also work against a regulatory environment that is very different from the competitive environment?
Yeah, so good question. I mean, I would say that most every big capital intensive business has a regulatory environment that's not all that different. And I think about just in the case of my business of higher education, there are certain requirements in terms of how many hours people need to be on campus for them to get a degree that certifies that they've done this or that. There's all kinds of requirements in terms of what the content of that degree has to be, the curriculum, etc. So we are probably an industry that has some of the highest regulation that you'll ever see in higher education. But that's not stopping any of the online universities and corporate training programs for doing what they're doing. Yeah, they're not taking us head on, and certainly if they did take us head on, we'd be very likely to respond to them. Imagine if Netflix had gone out from day one and started going after Blockbuster's mainstream customers. Blockbuster's response would have been rapid, would have been swift, and likely to be effective. The thing that makes it hard is that these disruptive innovators, they nibble at different parts of the market until they find a foothold, and that allows them to improve the technology without having sort of a competitive response. So I'd say the regulation is a piece of it. It's certainly something that affects things, but it hasn't affected a lot of these other industries that tend to be heavily regulated. And I would say that regulation is important, but there are other things going on. Good question. Yeah, we're here.
Is it, from my understanding,
utility industries.
Who is this talking?
Back to your left.
Okay. Is this a new question or the same one?
A new question.
Same person or?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry about that. Come back.
Of course.
But so I want to ask about the utility industry. We're sort of on the subject.
Sure. Yeah.
It hasn't changed a lot in a long time, and its structure was developed, slightly regulated.
Yeah.
Based on technologies that really depended on economies of scale. But that's changing with solar and with storage, so the technology should be generating a lot of disruption and regulation may be holding it back.
Yeah.
Like your take on what I see is probably the most sort of overdue disruption of this big centralized utility industry.
Yeah, great question. So you can tell that I like disruptive innovation, that's what I specialize in. 5 or 10 years ago, there's no way that I would ever be invited to a utility conference, and now I get a call every couple of weeks about going to a utility conference, and it's because these things are starting to shift. So you have something that has historically been, we've been trying to use technologies to compete head on with a deep-pocketed incumbent that's highly motivated to protect their business versus deploying the technology in other kind of ways. So you think about something like utilities, like, okay, we're serving the market now, but what happens when we have these technologies that come in that were initially very expensive that are now getting cheaper and cheaper? Initially they were unreliable and now they're becoming more reliable. Initially there was no complementary technologies, now there's lots of complementary technologies, including batteries and storage, which are all increasing at the same time. And that is what's creating the environment that's ripe for disruption. This is why utilities are thinking about this very, very carefully. Yeah, great question. More minutes.
Thank you.
More questions? Let me take one up front and I'll tell you what he says so that everybody can hear.
Has solar energy been a disruptor?
So has solar energy been a disruptor? So I think in my presentation I would say that 20 or 30 years ago, it was hard to claim that, because as I mentioned, you're sort of deploying it in competition with something that really is tough to go into competition against. And now a lot of things have changed on the technology side and on the business model side that's made it a viable alternative for a lot more people. And that came about by people discovering new niches that they didn't know were there, by relentlessly decreasing the cost so that it becomes competitive to the grid and other conventional technologies, and by having a set of complementary technologies that allow you to work in combination to take advantage where you're weak and take advantage of your strengths where you're strong. So I would say that, you know, 20 years ago, no. Right now, it's impossible to argue that it's not.
I've seen in the last 10 years that it has been, and that's where I feel these on tariffs have popped up, because we're up against a big challenge.
Yeah, there's a lot of non-market action going on too, right? Deep-pocketed people have a variety of different ways that they can fight against things, right? Not the least of which is competition, which is lobbying and all kinds of other things. Good. That?
What's your take on disrupting governments, the reveal, and virus?
And
batteries.
Batteries? So my take on disrupting government, I hadn't really thought much about disrupting government. I sort of thought that was like something you can't do, but maybe you can, I don't know. This is one of the wonderful things about being a professor. Is you just get to talk about it, and you guys have to do it all. So that obviously gives me some great comfort. If somebody actually is interested in disrupting government, I would say, go to town, but maybe don't call me. All right, last one. Got one more?
Right here, on the left. On the right. What's your opinion of initial coin offerings and you consider it disruptive?
Which one?
Initial coin offerings, ICOs.
So like markets for Bitcoin and things like that?
Yeah, so startups can create their own coins and raise funds.
Yeah, so good question. So if you don't mind, I'll take the precursor technology of Bitcoins instead of that one because it requires a little bit more explanation. But you think of something like Bitcoin, what is it? It's an alternative currency. Well, you know, how does it do? Well, it doesn't do very good relative to existing currencies. But that's exactly what we expect from a disruptive innovator, that it enters the market and is initially inferior compared to existing technologies. But it starts off in a market niche that values that. So in this case, it was, for example, let's call it the dark internet. Many people doing things that they might want out of the realm of other people finding out. It took root in those markets. It has improved over time to the extent where it's now getting it's so legitimate, like, by the way, that it can do some more things with it than it could do previously. I think Bitcoin absolutely fits the category of disruptive innovation. Okay, well, I want to be sensitive to time. I thank you all for your time. I really enjoyed it. And I hope we're going to get a chance to talk to you after this. And best of luck with the conference. Thank you very much.